Tonight I thought I'd start before I tell you a tongue-in-cheek story. I have a picture here of a Stradivarius. That is a 301-year-old Stradivarius violin. All of the remaining 650 violins and cellos are named. This is the Lipinski Stradivarius, which, as they all have wonderful stories, this was stolen 2 Januaries ago in a parking lot outside of Milwaukee and retrieved a couple of weeks later. It is worth somewhere around $5 million. The value is neither here nor there for me, but what I wanted to share with you is one of the, there are many incredible things on the Stradivarius other than the architecture and the unbelievable craftsmanship that went into creating that little beauty and all of the little beauties. We now believe that the sound, which is unparalleled, is ascribed to the wood, the different kinds of wood. There's high elevation spruce on the belly. There's river maple on the back. And there's pear wood on the purflings that go around. And those trees in the 16th and 17th and 18th century grew during a time on our planet of what we call the mini ice age. And so the tree rings are very close together. And when they're close together, they're dense. And the density, along with the craftsmanship, and of course, the supreme maestros that are making them sing, is like nothing else that we know on planet Earth right now. It stood the test of time. They will likely stand another 300, 500, 700 years. Occasionally, as one would imagine with wood, they wear and they go into a very deep restoration process, but they can be revived. So this leads into an interesting story. I believe that, as many of the first peoples around the world, the Aboriginals in Australia and our Native Americans, that each of us, 7.4 billion people, first of all, it's inconceivable, these numbers. And as we continue to go along, billions mean nothing, into the trillions, and so on and so forth. These are unfathomable numbers. And I put it to you like this, that within our lifetimes, that the planet has at least gone 2.5, and some of you, maybe, have almost seen threefold increase in the number of people. So for anyone on planet Earth to say, oh, we humans, we couldn't possibly do what we've done in terms of in excess of 51 trillion individual pieces of plastic in our oceans. The oceans, as a by the by, cover 71% of our gorgeous blue planet's face, but they actually take up 95% of the living space, or what we call the biosphere on planet Earth. It is unimaginable that you can test water, seawater, anywhere, and that you can find some of the gnarliest persistent organic pollutants, from DDT to PCBs to insecticides to flame retardant chemicals that are in everything in California. When you buy your sheets, you buy your towels, they got flame retardant. When you buy your little person's jumper suit that they sleep at night, kids' clothes, flame retardants. Anyway, they're in the oceans as well as many other chemicals. And the mere fact that we can test them in the oceans anywhere is a testament to how much poison we have created. It's a bit of a problem. However, we are all born with a purpose. And what you focus on, I can assure you, is what you will achieve. No matter what you want, no matter how great the odds are, there's nothing that a human mind cannot achieve. I'm positive of it. My story leads into just that. This little fellow, and ever since he was born and could walk, he knew he wanted to do one thing. He wanted to play the violin. That was his goal, and he was going to do it, and he did do it. He was walking down Fifth Avenue in the Green Apple, formerly called the Big Apple. And he came to the intersection of 5th and 57th, carrying his case. He had his first big gig at Carnegie Hall, and he was gonna, it was gonna be a showstopper. But he got to the intersection, he didn't know which way to turn, to the right or to the left. I don't know where Carnegie Hall is. So he asked the first person that he saw, an elderly Jewish woman, and said, how do I get to Carnegie Hall? And she looked at this little fellow and said, practice, practice, practice. The moral of the story is focus. All right. So tonight we will take another grand journey into the realm of focusing. And it's all within each of us. It's an interesting thing. And it's too bad the trillionaires aren't amongst us this evening. Although we're on tape, so maybe some of them will see this. The only thing that a human being can control, there's only one thing. There's only one thing that you might be able to control, ladies and gentlemen. It's your thoughts, your thought process. If you can control the thoughts, the endless streams of information that go through your brain every day and every night, certainly while you're awake, you would be the ultimate Zen master. So I urge you, and we will see why, to watch your thoughts. Because thoughts lead to feelings. And it's how you feel that makes a difference. It's true that storms don't last forever. We managed to survive Nixon. We managed to survive. We even managed to survive Bush. Ladies and gentlemen, Bush. Ladies and gentlemen, we will manage just fine to cope with the incoming administration. To cope. We will cope with them. I want to bring your attention to another incredible, there are many incredible people on planet Earth. We take the Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama is a wonderful shining example for all of us. He exhibits kindness to everyone. He lost his country. He lost his culture to a very brutal regime. He relies, ladies and gentlemen, on humor. On humor. He has taken his tragedy around the world into many teachable moments. It's a great paradigm for all of us to remember. That is one of my all-time favorites. There are 80,000 kinds of trees on our planet. The California coastal redwood is the king of the tree world for a number of reasons. I show you this because it's a great lead-in to mindfulness. Mindfulness is the practice of focusing on your awareness and your attention in the here and now. It's very important for us to come back to that because there's so much chatter. There's so much unnecessary chatter on these things. There's a terrific amount of misinformation or I call it disinformation today. And going back to nature helps us be centered. And it also, speaking of nature and our apples, it also reminds us to watch our thoughts. We can control what we think. If you're having a moment where you are stressing or where you're obsessing or where you're concerned for what may or may not be ahead, I encourage you to find several happy moments in your life. Maybe it's your puppy, maybe it's your lover, maybe it's your children. Maybe it's a great thing that happened to you throughout your life. You need to have these, what we call touchstones, so that you can pull yourself away from the negative moment. We know that when we're feeling low, that not only is our vibration measurably lower, but we attract other people and other incidents that are low vibration. For instance, if you have an argument or if you have, you're feeling upset, I urge you, don't get in your car. Because if you get in your car and you're vibing low, there's a chance, just saying, that you'll attract somebody else in a low moment, and that's when leave collisions happen. So when you get in your car, think happy thoughts, right? Don't think anything other than that. Now, in the 1970s, a wonderful experiment, this is a tuning fork. And my colleagues set these tuning forks in the same room. Would you believe they all found the same vibration, right? So when we vibrate high, when we're thinking about what makes us joyous, you attract unknown good things. Think of the tuning fork, ladies and gentlemen. Now, the only constant in life is change. And we can choose to do two things. Most people choose to resist it. The wiser ones choose to go with the river of life. When you go with the river of life, it produces less stress, right? And it produces interesting results. When you get stressed, breathe. Stop wherever you are and take breaths that go to the bottom. Breathe. If you take a few breaths, whatever's stressing you, leave you quickly. And with the incoming array of people in DC, we will all be taking deep breaths. It's a good thing. Also, we know that we are divided. We understand that. Agreeing to disagree is okay. I'm just saying that if you know somebody is supports a different party than you, disengage. If you disengage, you're not going to have this. I don't think we need any more of this, certainly for the next while. At least your blood pressure doesn't. When we accept things, interesting things happen. Now, we have to accept the outcome, and that's just a fact. But it does not mean that we go silent. Whatever you do, ladies and gentlemen, do not go silent. Today, more than ever, write. Write a blog. WordPress.com is free. Start a petition. change.org. Better still, demonstrate. Organize a demonstration. Voice your concerns. Thankfully, we live in the United States of America. where we can demonstrate. Imagine if you were in China or Russia. You can't do that. We can do that. Please demonstrate at all possible points in time. We use this. This is a poster I have in my studio. Never, ever, ever give up. My colleagues each year, bless them, warriors, they go to Taiji and they bear witness and they continue to go there because it is not right and because we will never give up on our brothers and our sisters, the cetaceans, the whales, dolphins, and porpoises. I'll be speaking about them in a minute because they are actually pivotal to our success on planet Earth. Never be silent, ever. I was lamenting earlier, for good reason, it appears that today more than ever, we have people that, high-ranking people, that will not stand up. Stand up for what is right, stand up for our planet, stand up for the animals, and stand up for their children. And more than ever, ladies and gentlemen, this is a pivotal time on our planet because if you can't stand up now for our planet, then when can you? Right? False evidence appearing. Think about that. False evidence appearing real. How many of us have been at a nightmare or stressed on something that you thought was going to happen and it made you feel terrible, low, possibly gave you chest pains or whatever? False evidence appearing real. Fear. Do not become a victim of fear. More today than ever. Are fearful of what? Of the sky falling, of standing up, of speaking truth, of demonstrating, of change? Nah. Nature is incredible. I want you to, it's a forest setting. I'd like you to think on this for a second. There is no waste in nature. There is no unemployment. Everything works together. Trees are a terrific example. When trees and forests come together, they change their environment. Humidity is much higher in a forest. They create clouds. For every 1 ton of wood, which is the carbon dioxide, a ton and a half of carbon dioxide that they suck out of the air, that they make the wood, trees give off 1 ton of oxygen. Trees are a bastion for fresh water. A third of all the cities on planet Earth rely on trees for their drinking water. And of course, their homes for all the critters. And many of the plants are of high medicinal value. Nature has everything to offer us. In fact, it has a perfect blueprint just waiting for us to mimic. These are Australian head-banging little bees. They're blue-banded bees. This year, we discovered there's over 2,000 kinds of bees in Australia. These are very, very, very small little critters. They perform an interesting way of extracting the pollen from a flower. They pull into the flower and they bang their head continuously against the male stamen and the pollen just pours off. Now, we didn't even know that until 6 months ago. We'd never seen it. A colleague of mine captured it on film and it was like, OMG. Now, how could that be applicable to us? Well, it turns out that a bunch of the foods we eat onions, peppers, a bunch of the gourds, beans, rely on a form of pollination where bumblebees, you see, they're pretty famous, they're much larger than these little kids, they pull into the flower, and much like tonight, when you go home, if you lift off your shirt, your hair will electrostatically go up, the bumblebee is charged, and they spin around a 360 very quickly, and all the pollen goes and glungs onto them. And it's called a sonification or buzz pollination, and it's crucial for many of the edible plants that we eat. Situation in Australia, there's no bumblebees. Bumblebees are not native to Australia. So what we've had to do in glasshouses, they call them glasshouses, we call them greenhouses, we have to mechanically pollinate the plants. These little fellows, these little girls, excuse me, bees are all almost all female, they're now being used in the greenhouses to pollinate our food. How good is that? Very. Here are our friends. They are incredible. The elephants. The elephants remind us that being the biggest kid on the block doesn't mean that you can't have the biggest heart. They are run, they're a female-driven society. They are sentient. They mourn the loss of their dead. They bury their dead. They create water holes for all of the African animals. They create salt licks for all of the animals. They create the entire acacia woodland forest behind there by eating the seeds and defecating these huge fertilizer packs. They plant the forest everywhere they go. The elephants also create fire breaks that protect people and all of the villages. What we have discovered this year, which is very staggering, is the population of elephants we thought was 700,000. We now know that the population is more 356,000. We have, each of us have a stake in this. In America, we are the second largest ivory consumer in the world. And that is inexcusable. It is, of course, against the law that the ivory comes in, but much like drugs, some drugs that are against the law, they come in. I urge each of you to tell anybody who would think of buying ivory not to buy ivory, because we need the elephants, because the elephants create an entire ecosystem for all animals and all life. Here we have a humpback whale. Humpbacks are incredible whales. These are 50-ton creatures. They have the largest pectoral fins, pecs, of any of the whales. They are huge, and they have what's called a baleen here. It's like an accordion. When they open their mouths, it stretches, and they are after, in most cases, very tiny little miniature-like shrimp called krill, though they do eat fish too and other small creatures. The humpbacks teach us a lot. The humpbacks are phenomenal musicians, and they have a song. Their song is their language. Their language changes, ladies and gentlemen, every decade. They change what they're saying every decade. It is humbling. My colleagues understand they have a language, and we are trying as best as we can to decipher what they're saying. The whales have been on our planet for at least 60, but maybe closer to 100 million years. They are the king monarchs of the sea, and I'm going to show you in a moment why we need them, but the mere fact that they teach us how important song is and music is, many people gravitate to music, particularly in challenging times. Music is tonic for the soul. Humpbacks are also very famous for breaching, getting out of the water. They do it, but there are over 85 different kinds of whales, dolphins, and porpoises. Humpbacks breach more often than any other whale, dolphin, or porpoise, and they do it for a number of reasons. One, they do it as the males to show their level of fitness. The stronger the splash, the stronger they appear by the sound to the female, and in nature, the female only wishes to pass the strongest genes on. We think they also breach because they get sea lice, and when you've got 40 or 50 tons coming down on the water, it smashes any of the sea lice off. Also, in very rough waters, it's far easier for them to communicate by breaching, splashing, sending information rather than by song, which doesn't work. And lastly, ladies and gentlemen, they teach us that breaching is fun. They like to have fun. I gotta say, fun is underrated, and we all need more fun. So they teach us that other animals like to have fun too. Here I show you, these are sperm whales. Sperm whales are incredible animals. They're world record holders in a number of interesting facts. These sperm whales, this is obviously a female and her calf. The males get to be 55 feet long and almost 60 tons, double the females, and they all can go down 2 miles deep in the ocean, and they can spend up to a couple of hours deep in the ocean holding their breath. It's mind-boggling. I want to bring to your attention before I go back to the deep divers. We now know that they have a different dialect all over the planet. Just like people, they have different languages. Sperm whales are helping all of us because when they go very deep into the oceans, they have a very stable protein in their blood. That stable protein, it's a myoglobin, is helping my colleagues at Rice University and elsewhere develop synthetic blood for emergency transfusions. These creatures are incredible. Sadly, they were hunted mercilessly for the spermaceti in their large brains that we burned in candles. It was the cleanest burn, and up to 15, 20 years ago, the Russians were still killing sperm whales to make nuclear missiles. They are protected. The populations are all very lowly, and what they are telling us in the Gulf of Mexico, this fracking is the devil on steroids times infinity. In 2014, in the Gulf of Mexico, in America, American wells, we dumped 75 billion gallons of toxic wastewater directly into the Gulf. As a result, the resident 1,300 to 1,400 female and calves, they stay there all year long, are the most toxic whales on planet Earth. This toxicity, what we do to the whales and to the oceans, we do to ourselves. it's unacceptable, and I'm elated, as many people were yesterday, with President Obama enacting the 1953 law to suspend offshore drilling on the most of the Arctic and the Atlantic, because much of the offshore drilling, unbeknownst to many, includes fracking, and they're fracking everywhere now. The whales are telling us that we can't do that. Speaking of whales, I would be most remiss not to mention one of my favorite groups and favorite organizations on planet Earth, Sea Shepherd, particularly seashepherd.org.au, my Australian friends. This year, actually 2 years ago, they won an award from the Dutch postcode lottery, as well as the UK and Sweden postcode lottery, the equivalent of approximately $12 or $13 million, and they made from scratch a new boat, the first time in 4 decades of being in the ocean and protecting the whales. They got a new boat. This is a very fast boat. This boat is able to outrun the Japanese whale catchers. This red cannon on the back fires water, and it throws so much water onto the whaling ships, they can't see anything. They can't see anything. They can't kill my whales, right? So they are there right now because Japan, once again, has unlawfully gone into the Southern Ocean to murder whales against the International Court of Justice, against the Australian Federal Court, and Sea Shepherd is an ocean warrior, and Steve Irwin, another Sea Shepherd boat, are there right now protecting our friends, the whales. And the whales are incredible on so many different levels. The 2 million years ago, the newest whale to evolve, newest small 14-ton whale to evolve, is called the minke whale. And the minke whales, nature always hedges her bets, either far to the right or far to the left, having the blue whale, which is in excess of a couple hundred tons, down to this little 14-ton whale. Nature might have thought maybe something was going to happen. Maybe there may not be enough food. I'm going to bring in the minkes. And the minkes were ruthlessly hunted during the whaling season, but they were so small that the whalers, for the first couple hundred years, were murdered over 5 million whales. Almost 3 million were murdered last century. In many cases, they didn't go after the smaller whales, and now Japan is into the minke whales. The question is, are the Japanese people starving? No. What are they doing with the whales? Well, they're forcing whale meat into the school lunch program, and they're turning the rest of our whales into dog food. It is incorrigible. It is run 110% by the Japanese government, who does not, they have no regard for the whales. So let's say in the audience, you were all on the other side and you felt that the whales were expendable and we could get rid of them and who cares, and yada, yada, yada. As a scientist today, it's not good enough to be passionate or humbled by the exquisiteness of nature. I can tell you the most important reason why we need every last whale, dolphin, and porpoise alive is because we need oxygen. You might be surprised by that our friends, the whales, and their flocculent fecal plumes, their scat, is helping to fertilize the basis of the entire marine ecosystem, the phytoplankton, the plants. The phytoplankton and a blue-green bacteria in the ocean, a Prochlorococcus, give us approximately 2 out of every 3 breaths of air wherever you live on planet Earth. we have a problem. The oceans, ladies and gentlemen, have warmed so much in the last 200 years that it's the number that Lawrence Livermore came out with earlier this year, 300 zetajoules, is a meaningless number unless you're into zetajoules. We can tell you that 150 of the 300 zetajoules that of energy in our oceans has occurred from 1997. The equivalent of one Hiroshima-style atomic bomb being detonated every second for 75 consecutive years. Our oceans are warming 1.5 to 5 times faster than anything on the land. Now, how does that fit into the whales? Well, as a part of the warming oceans, the cold currents aren't upwelling. They're not rising to the surface, carrying nitrogen and iron. Without the nitrogen and iron, ladies and gentlemen, we're missing 40% of the phytoplankton, the oxygen. Oh, yes. The whales are helping to put the nitrogen and the iron in their poo back into the oceans to regrow the 40% missing phytoplankton. Because, Houston, we have a big problem. From Scripps Institute at UC San Diego, since at least 1990, I think the data goes back to 1985, they've been measuring molecular oxygen in our atmosphere. What you can see is both from Cape Grim, the tip of Tasmania, gorgeous place if you ever get a chance, go to Tasmania, it's heaven, great trees, awesome. And La Jolla, the same situation. We're missing 19 oxygen molecules per million each year. We're missing today approximately 600 oxygen molecules per 1 million. Not disturbing us during the day hours, I assure you. There's over 60 million Americans who suffer from sleep deprivation. You take oxygen out of the atmosphere, you don't sleep. Hello. This is from Scripps Institute. The whales are helping us breathe. Great news. Today, we've got some extraordinary news. Children, never underestimate their intelligence or their will to survive. In Washington State, these children and a few others in their group got the green light from a judge that said that children can take the Department of Ecology and the state of Washington and the governor of Washington to court, both state and federal, because the Department of Ecology is not protecting them from a stable climate, and their inaction is not only costing them, but by doing nothing, it may be too late. And the judge said, you are allowed to take this to court. The kids are going to make waves. Yes! Now, you might be pleasantly surprised to know that while D.C. and the puppets funded by the fossil corporations are saying everything is fine, there's over 1,060 mayors from Malibu to Miami that have an agreement that are making phenomenal changes. In Malibu, for instance, we're the first city in America to have given the whales, dolphins, and porpoises the right to life. Our council understands that the whales are crucial to help us breathe. Yes! In Miami, they've got a problem, Houston. The water's coming up. Now, not only is the water rising, but the salt water is leaking into the groundwater and it's contaminating the groundwater. It's also pushing sewage up to where there are people. So the mayor of Miami has raised $400 million to begin to create levees to lift roads and to future-proof Miami from rising sea levels. We also have extraordinary, the American College and University President's Climate Commitment. 17 million people at over 650 tertiary institutions in America have climate plans, climate action, and we, those little cities, are making an enormous difference. Oh, there's more good news. In the last 15 months, ladies and gentlemen, over 660 charities, governments, faith-based organizations, and 59,399 individuals have removed $5 trillion in investment from fossil fuels. They've divested $5 trillion. At the same time, from July to September in this year, every 32 minutes, America added 1 megawatt of solar. We have just under 36 gigawatts of solar in America. That's enough to power almost 7 million homes. Oh, yes, technology is our friend. This year, we saw the deployment for the first time. This is innovation energy, and this is the Blue Mull Sound near the Shetland Islands, Scotland. They've deployed 5 underwater turbines that are hooked into the current, just sitting there, the current's passing, the turbines are spinning. The Shetland Islands are off grid, and off the coast of France, the Brittany coast, One Hydro has just deployed a huge array of these tidal turbines that just sit there, and as the current moves, they make energy. And they're interconnected, so this is the future, not coal. I encourage everyone, I'm sure everybody in this room needs no encouragement, but I encourage everyone to plant a couple of fruit trees. Food is very important in your own garden, your own yard, not only for us, but these tangerines, for instance, are bee pollinated, so they're providing a safe haven for our bees. Instead of having a lawn that just sucks water, raise a couple of beds, grow your food, grow your herbs, grow your tomatoes or radishes, and you will see quite quickly that when you go to the garden, your blood pressure goes down, you feel more zen, you're breathing air. The bees, for the kids, it's a great way to introduce children to bees, food, and bounty, and it's a win-win for us all. The most important thing in agriculture, in any agriculture, is the soil. What we do to the soil, we do to ourselves. The raised beds help us create our own soil, maintain our soil. I encourage everyone to have a raised bed or raised pots. Also, in the summer, our bees need to drink. Easy to take a bowl of marbles, put water, allow some of the marbles to poke up above the water because it's hot, and the bees, they need to drink. We need bees. By the way, this year in America, we had our worst bee losses. Near 44% of our honeybees died. This is very serious. So by creating safe havens in our yards and our gardens for the bees, we're working for the good guys. The single biggest thing that anybody can do right this very second is to switch your diet to a plant-based diet. because animal agriculture contributes over 18% to the climate altering, heat trapping gases that is higher than the entire transportation sector globally. Now, I realize for some, it's a major step. The way we write a book, like any of these books, is one chapter at a time. So instead of saying to yourself, I couldn't possibly do that, I say, try one day a week, plant-based. When you get that under your belt, try 2 days, and you'll find that our plant-based diet is easy, it's healthy, it's water smart, and ladies and gentlemen, more than anything else, it's compassionate. We need more compassion today than ever before. The other thing each of us can do, and I encourage, is to join an organization that is close to your heart in the environment or whatever organization it is, because you'll find like-minded people, and when you're around like-minded people working for the common good, you will find that your vibration goes up, you'll meet new people working for the common good, and in the environment today, we need all of you to get involved. Lastly, don't forget to smile. Smiling is the most important thing that each of us can do when you're feeling a little low. Smile. It releases endorphins in your brain, and it's a great way to kickstart a low vibration into feeling better